We're living in some crazy times, folks. Anybody knows that?
No.
This isn't your mom and dad's America, is it? I don't think my dearly departed parents would recognize what's going on in this country. But we have a real chance at reversing all of that on November the 8th. And so I wanted to just have a meeting tonight that's going to do two things. We're going to talk about a Georgia issue tonight. We're going to talk about a federal issue tonight. The most important thing I can think of in our Georgia issues, which is also a federal issue, which, and Mr. Trump may be helping us solve our Georgia issues with education, is education itself. Because if we don't educate our young people with the truth, then what good is it? Our kids have got to understand the truth, and they've got to understand how to apply the truth in their lives. We're going to talk about truth throughout this evening as well, because it's vitally important. So the first folks I'm going to ask to come up here are Karen Solhiem and Sally Swift. Karen has been the president, this is Karen, president of the Georgia Association of Educators, retired organization. Is that so?
I'm over the hill.
You're okay. All right. And prior to that, she spent 29 years in public education teaching English and drama students in 8th grades 7 through 12. And she worked in the Jefferson City Schools for 20 years, and the Oconee County Schools for 9 years, and I had to abbreviate all the rest of it.
But
she is eminently qualified to be talking on the subject matter she's talking on tonight. Now, Sally Swift has been involved in public education for 30 years in various capacities. She was employed by the Daugherty County School System for 12 years and chose to work on more difficult schools. Sally's been employed by the Georgia Association of Educators for the past 18 years, and her duties with GAE have given her the opportunity to work in 40 different school systems. So these ladies are eminently qualified to be talking on the subject of education. Mike?
I would like to suggest that everyone use the microphone so that the recordings can pick up the sound better.
All right. Very good.
Can everyone hear? Is it too loud? You good? Okay.
Hey, Hank.
Yeah.
Also, we've got plenty of signs back, opposition signs back here, so you're just aware. Right here, I brought boxes of signs in.
What kind of signs?
Opposition signs to Amendment 1 right there.
All right. Very good. All right.
Karen.
I was going to say, Sally. I'm going to turn it over to Karen, right?
Yeah, go ahead.
All right. There you go.
Thank you so much, and thanks for coming out this evening. And I need you to give me a finger, and the appropriate one when I ask, please, is if you really feel confident talking about Amendment 1, if you kind of have heard of it sideways, and if you're like, Amendment 1, we're having an election, a thumbs down. So this would be the time you give me a finger this way, or this way. Okay, I just kind of wanted to see who the audience was in the room, and thank you for that. And if you need my contact information after all this is over and done and you want to talk to me, I'll be happy to give that to you one-on-one. And as Hank said, I'm a former English teacher, so today we're going to keep it simple, and we're only going to count to four because I can do that. And we're going to talk about four things concerning what's going on for November 8th. And Amendment 1. And the first one is audience participation with one ballot amendment. And on the ballot, and for some of you in the back, you may have to squint at this point in time, will there be Amendment 1 the way it is, or are we interested in Amendment 4 the way it's written? So this is audience participation. Somebody shout out an answer.
No.
That is not, it's either A or B, Stephen.
I have my glasses on, excuse me.
Well, B is what it really is.
Exactly. So if you haven't early voted yet, with early voting starting this past Monday, when you go to the polls, the amendment that I'm concerned about as being a previous public school educator is Amendment 1. There will be four amendments in all, and the language for the one below isn't what's going to appear on the ballot. So if you're going through and you're talking to people about the Opportunity School District, that really isn't going to appear on the ballot. What you are going to see on the ballot is the 24 words, as I refer to them, that we've known about for over a year, about amending the Georgia Constitution. And it says, to allow the state to intervene in chronically failing public schools in order to improve student performance. And people will see, improve student performance, yeehaw, that's what we want to do. And they'll go through and they perhaps will vote not the way my organization would like them to. And then to go through and sweeten it, we finally did find out a couple months ago what amendment number it was. So it's good to be able to tell people to vote no on one. But then they added about, 6 weeks ago, the preamble. And doesn't this sound like the best thing since sliced bread? Amendment one provides greater flexibility and state accountability to fix failing schools through increasing community involvement. And I'm not quite sure how that is supposed to happen through this amendment, but we have, GAE has filed a lawsuit against the language of Amendment 1. We probably will not have an outcome before the election, but it does go through and raise and hold up the fact that perhaps the wording of Amendment 1, and maybe other amendments, but I'm just talking about Amendment 1, isn't as clear as it could be.
The legislators did not vote on that preamble or the wording, and that's one of the main reasons for the lawsuit.
Who wrote it?
Yeah, that's who you go after.
Do you have staffers right now?
Yes.
Start naming names.
And I will at the end. So when you go to the ballot, you only have the yes or no choice on Amendment 1 with the preamble and with the 24 words. You don't get to check maybe or anything else that you might want to write in. You have to check yes or no, and you can't say, oh, I'll think about this later. Not appearing on the ballot, but part of the long sheet that each of you were handed on one side, you'll see what Senator Vincent Fort put out, trying to get the language of the 24 words substituted. It did not pass, but this is a pretty accurate assessment of what Amendment 1 really should say. Amending the Constitution to allow an appointee of the governor to bypass the elected state school superintendent in order to take over local school operations, buildings, and control of all federal, state, and local funding if a school has low scores on standardized tests or for any other reason a future legislative act may allow. And I'm pausing on those last five words, future legislative act may allow. I'll talk about that in just a minute. Also, as I mentioned, not appearing on the November 8th ballot is anything about the words Opportunity School District. And if you're in education, you always like to abbreviate things, so we talk about the OSD. You will not find that at all on the ballot. We're up to 2 of 4. Two pieces of legislation. The first came about, both of these did, at the 2015 General Assembly. And this Senate resolution provides what the people will see on the ballot in terms of the 24 words. So again, we've known about the 24 words for a while. And then it provides the actual language, should this pass, that will be inserted into the Georgia Constitution. Because if you remember, it starts out, shall the Constitution of Georgia be amended? So two paragraphs will be inserted if this passes, and this is the wording for those. And this is where we get the term Opportunity School District, because that's the title of the two paragraphs. And if you read really quickly what's in red, you'll see that the first paragraph deals with the schools themselves. And the second paragraph deals with the money aspect of it. And nowhere in the insertion into the Georgia Constitution is there anything about what we're going to do to help students or teachers or academics. As my representative, I live over in Athens, Clark, says, this is a facilities management piece of legislation. It deals with the buildings and the revenue connected with those buildings. Second piece of legislation I carry around with me if you want to see it, it's the Senate Bill 133, and it's the enabling legislation. It's about 13 pages. So this is what is the workings should this amendment pass. And I go through and I say the workings for now. Because these 13 pages of the Senate bill, it's a resolution and we kind of know how we're going to operate, at least for now, if this amendment passes. But remember the part of any future legislative act? If these two paragraphs are inserted into the Constitution, then any future legislature can come along and change the recipe for the state takeover. So right now, I kind of liken this, because I like to eat, that we have a recipe for chocolate chip cookies. We know the ingredients, the bake time, the mix time, the prep time, blah, blah, blah. But a future legislature can come along and say, oh, we don't like chocolate chip, let's make oatmeal raisin. And go through and change the ingredients, change the cook time, etc. Three models that this particular OSD, Opportunity School District, is based on. And if you want to do your homework and gather facts for yourself, you're more than welcome. We have the Recovery School District in Louisiana, came about after Hurricane Katrina. And then we have the Michigan Education Achievement Authority. And lastly, the Tennessee Achievement School District. And just a paragraph or so that you probably can't read from the back, and I apologize for that. But Diane Ravitch, who's a public education proponent, she goes through earlier this year and she takes these three school districts, these state takeover districts, to task. And for the Recovery School District at the very end, she had said some critics have called it the lowest performing district in one of the lowest performing states. And then for Michigan, she says it has no defenders. It's a disaster. And lastly, with the Tennessee Achievement District, she cites research and it says the lowest performing schools are still very low performing schools. So we have models we've used that haven't been successful. So I'm not sure the model that we're putting forth will be. Three things to know, we're only going to four. So the what, the who, and the when. The what. We've been talking about failing schools. So we need to know what the criteria are for failing schools. Anybody know besides Stephen, who's an educator, and his lovely wife back there? Anybody else know what the criteria is?
Passing the test?
It does have to do with passing the test. And it's actually a little bigger picture than that. If a school is deemed as failing, it has an F rating, and that is currently by the recipe defined as being a 60 or below, again, an arbitrary number that is in the recipe at this point, on something called the CCRPI. Which is abbreviation, you can see, for the College and Career Ready Performance Index, which is a measure that was never designed to give a school a score. It was designed to see whether a student is ready for the work of the career work or college work. And in education over the last 3 years, even what's emphasized in the CCRPI is weighted differently from year to year. So across 3 years, we're not comparing apples to apples. We kind of have a fruit salad going on. And inherent also in the CCRPI, which is based on largely on test scores, it's also a school can have a low score if it has a high absentee rate. And I'm not quite sure how a school can go through and make students physically attend school, but I'm not in charge. And then a low graduation rate. I mean, somebody may have to drop out for a reason. And then having the low scores on standardized tests, and my diatribe on standardized tests can be left for another day. But suffice it to say, the Georgia Milestones test, which is the standardized test and company used in Georgia, the scores for the last couple years have been thrown out for students and not counted because of testing irregularities. But yet these milestone scores count for teachers in the teacher's evaluation and go and are rolled into the CCRPI scores for schools. So again, just seems like it should count for everybody or not count for everybody. If the amendment passes, according to the recipe so far, there could be in the Opportunity School District up to 100 failing schools. And a school would stay in for a minimum of 5 years, maximum of 10 years, unless it's successful for 3 years in a row and then it can come out. And up to 20 failing schools can be put in the OSD per year. And you can Google online and you can see the list of the failing schools. The test results came out in May of this year. And based on CCRPI scores 60 or below, three consecutive years, we have 127 failing schools in Georgia, which represent 22 school systems. And you can see by the map, hopefully, that there are a lot in the metro Atlanta area, and then we have some dispersed in other areas of the state. And are there any in Hall County? No, okay, there aren't any in Hall County. And a lot of times when I do these presentations, people will say, well, why should we be concerned? It's not in our county. Well, realize the recipe has the 60 or below in there as an ingredient for now. A future legislature can come through and say, oh, let's make it 75 or below. Or let's make it 5% on a growth model, and if a school's at a 96%, it's never going to get the full 5%. Stephen?
There are actually quite a number of schools, though, that are at risk for this. They're borderline.
Are they focused schools?
I beg your pardon?
Are they focused schools? They're next on the list.
Well, they're missing it by 1 year scores.
So people who are going through and saying, oh, we don't have to worry, maybe not in today's recipe, but we may be changing the ingredients. And the schools, the 127 schools, represent 6% of the schools in Georgia. So we'd be working towards, according to this amendment, changing the Constitution for 6% of the schools and less than 4% of the students in Georgia. So it's not as if we have a wholesale problem. And yes, we do have some struggling schools. And based on the CCRPI and the failing schools from the previous year, you can see that it's high minority students of the 139 failing schools from the previous year, and 92% of them are on free and reduced lunch. And the who on this is the governor, and whoever that might be, currently Governor Deal. And what he's going to do, according to the recipe, is to appoint an Opportunity School District superintendent to run the OSD. And the superintendent would be selected by the governor. He has to be approved by the Georgia Senate, but he doesn't have to have any additional criteria other than what any local school superintendent has to have, which is breathing and high school degree. So it doesn't have to go through and be somebody who's melded into education or has a business background. It can be whoever the governor decides. And that person's going to be housed in the governor's office of student achievement. Now, those of us, in education, remember that there's also a Georgia Department of Education. And we go through and we elected Richard Woods in the last go around to be the state school superintendent. And if we don't like what Richard Woods does, then we unelect him and find somebody else to run in the next go-around. So we're in essence having a dual education bureaucracy set up through passing this amendment, one with an elected superintendent in the DOE, and then one with an appointed superintendent in the governor's office of student achievement. And it's not like, Sally mentioned just a minute ago, focus schools. It's not like the DOE isn't going through and addressing struggling schools. It has two programs, focus schools, priority schools, which are addressing Title I schools and students who might need some extra help. So it's not like we're ignoring where there needs to be funds put and extra energy put within the state. When? If this passes, it goes into effect January 1, 2017. The recipe says that the appointed superintendent by April 1st has to let the schools he's chosen know that they'll go into the OSD. The schools, it'll take place starting the next school year. And we're up to number four, four intervention models. What happens to a school that's selected for the Opportunity School District is based solely on the appointed superintendent. He gets to decide. And there are four intervention models in all. He can decide that the school will be part of a statewide school district. So he'll have schools from all over the state in one school district. And DeKalb County has about 125 schools within that one county, and that's large. I'm not quite sure how we'll deal with after-school competitions, just with the students going and competing against each other. And right now, if I don't like what's happening in my school system, I can go about 10 miles down the road and talk to my superintendent in my county. People will have to go to Atlanta to talk to the OSD superintendent. Second model, shared governance. Again, the OSD superintendent gets to decide if this is an option. And what this means, he just says, oh, we're going to play nicely with the local education authority. Except I, as OSD superintendent, get to appoint the principal for that school. And every failing school in the OSD will have a governing board, and the OSD superintendent gets to decide who's on that governing board. The third one, the school could, according to the OSD superintendent, become a charter school. And if it's tapped for this option, once it becomes a charter school, it can never revert back to anything else. And this allows for-profit and non-profit entities to come in our state. And according to the State Charter Commission, not only could bus drivers be privatized, cafeteria workers, parapros, but the teaching staff that's credentialed could be fired. And then people, according to the State Charter Commission, again, who are breathing and have a high school degree, could be elected to be the teachers at a charter school. And the last one, the OSD superintendent could decide to close down the school. Students are bused throughout the district, never mind it might take them more hours on the school bus to get to and from school. Staff is dispersed throughout the district if there's room. And if there needs to be a reduction in force, the school district, the local school district, gets to deal with that. And if a facility is closed, it cannot reopen as the same kind of grade level facility for 3 years. So in Athens-Clark, we have Gaines Elementary on the list. If the OSD superintendent taps that school to go into the OSD, it's closed down. It cannot open as an elementary school for 3 years. It could open as a middle school, a high school, but I'm not sure the football players could quite fit in the little desks. And again, this is at the discretion of the appointed superintendent. He has to hold at least one public hearing to get community input. I guess that's involving the community. But if you don't like the decision, well, that's really too bad, because according to the recipe, there is no appeals process for this. He is the sole decider. And follow the money? This is a revenue neutral piece of legislation. It means there's no new funding put in. And this is a quote from the website on the Governor's Opportunity School District. The schools within the OSD are entitled to all local, state, and federal funds that were available to the school prior to the transfer of the school into the OSD. Which means if Gaines Elementary closes in my community, my local tax dollars for that school are now part of the operating budget for the OSD, less up to 3% that can be kept out, according to the current recipe, for administrative costs by the OSD. So it's not necessarily getting even the full funding. And again, my local tax dollars for education will be sent to the state for the operation of it. And then the General Assembly may appropriate additional funds to be allocated among the schools within the OSD at the discretion of the OSD superintendent for necessary and innovative purposes. So if there's not enough money, and there hasn't been enough money in public education since the inception of the current funding formula in 1985, QBE, Quality Basic Education, it's not ever been fully funded. Educators have gone through austerity cuts, furlough days, etc. But in order to, you know, make sure the OSD has enough money, this is an option. And my rationale is there's only one pot of money in Georgia that can be allocated, and education's a pretty good portion of that. But if some is taken off for operation of the Opportunity School District, it means less funding for education in the local districts throughout the state. And it does allow for philanthropic funding. People with deep pockets can come in and contribute. And again, contract with nonprofit and for-profit providers. So it does say private funds may be solicited to support these schools. The facilities, if my lovely Gaines Elementary is taken over for the OS by the OSD, everything that's within the building, the computer, the chairs, the tables, the books, the flower pots, whatever, now belong to the Opportunity School District. Except if the roof leaks or the air conditioner stops, then the local district is responsible for major capital repairs. So you will not see this language on the ballot. But I hope through going through this, it makes a little more sense why Vincent Ford wanted to change and have this language, because again, I think it's a fairly accurate translation of what Amendment 1 is. Instead, you'll get Amendment 1, the preamble, and the 24 words. So thank you so much for listening, sir.
Question for you. Now, the state of Georgia would never go into something like this with the idea that the new program is going to fail. No, it's going to be wildly successful. And so let's just assume that the program is wildly successful and that all of the schools that are put into this program all of a sudden start producing students with incredible scores. And then that being the case, they no longer are failing schools. So then they would then rightly, justifiably, be given back to the regular school system because this is for failing schools. So if that actually happened, it seems like to me that the new school superintendent and all of the staff that are underneath him are working themselves out of a job by performing and creating a program that actually works. Isn't that?
I think there was a question in there.
Am I saying this right?
You are. And the lens I look through, too, is if there were a panacea for public education that's working for everybody in Georgia or across the nation, by gosh, by golly, let's get on the bandwagon and let's do this. But whoever comes in on Monday morning, it's still going to be those same students that need educating. So
I want to give y'all a little history about this. There's a group called Students First that is for privatizing public schools. They are the ones that paid for the legislators in the governor's office to go see the New Orleans model several years ago. and they wind and dine them and all that. But the scores show that it's not working, and last May, they gave the schools back. The Michigan model that she talked about, the governor came out in June. This legislation, he has wrote legislation for it to go back into the public schools because it hasn't worked in Michigan. There are several lawsuits in Tennessee where the money has been mismanaged and has now disappeared, and there's no money to educate the children.
You're kidding me.
No, you can Google it. It's all over the place. So those are a few things that, you know, it hasn't worked anywhere else. They're having major problems in Florida with some that they've privatized like this. So, I mean, I ask that people do the research. If you get out there and do your research, you can see that this hasn't worked. Why do we want to bring it into Georgia if it hadn't worked? And another thing I wanted to let you know, the funding that we're talking about, if they go for a private charter, Michelle Reeves' husband owns one of the largest for-profit chains. If you trace back the money to all the legislators that helped write the bill, along with the governor, they all got donations in their campaign from these for-profit charter companies, and Governor Deal got over $4 million. Freddie Paul Sims, which was one of the deciding votes to make this happen, who co-sponsored the bill, got a new arts theater at Albany State College that they've denied for the last 15 years, but all of a sudden she's got a several million dollar building. So if you ever trace the money, it tells you a whole lot. Yes, sir.
It's my understanding Senator Butch Miller was one of the proponents of this. Did he get anything special that you're aware of?
We looked at all the ones that co-sponsored the bill, and every one of them got different amounts for their campaign re-election last year. So you can actually go, it's all public information, and it will tell you how much and who donated to their, but every one of them got money from the for-profit charter companies. I remember Governor Deal's because it was $4 million.
Derrick.
Yes, sir.
There's something more sinister going on in this that's not being talked about because it's ugly. I already voted against this the first day of voting. Thank you. If you looked at the map of where the schools were concentrated, Atlanta, around the Cab area, I live in the Cab and I work in Fulton County area. There is massive gentrification taking place. Gentrification is basically where the face of a neighborhood changes over time. Properties are bought up, rehabbed. The people that generally lived in the neighborhood can no longer afford to live in that neighborhood, and they are forced outward. Those schools that the governor wants control of the money and the building and the resources for is to facilitate shutting down those schools that mostly poor blacks and poor whites attend. And once they are gone, they will be repurposed because the governor will be controlling. And one thing we always forget, the experiment is always done, unfortunately, on the Negro first, and why this would be so advantageous for the governor. You already got kids that don't want to be in school in these failing schools. And you got parents that give little to no participation whatsoever. And when people read the language as it is on the ballot, white people are going to say, oh, so they want to make schools better. And black folks are going to say, oh, so now they're going to come in and do something about these bad schools. But that's not what happened, and she just laid it out for you. And my fear is that it will pass, and you will see the end of the school system for black folks. And guess what? Once they succeed with the black folks, white folks will be next.
I would like to introduce Briana Bivens. She is this region's coalition for the state campaign on keep Georgia schools local. We have yard signs we brought. I have extra information and materials. But it's going to take all of us together working to stop this. If I go tell 10, Briana goes tell 10, Karen goes tell 10, and their 10 goes tell 10, we have to actually have 2,140,000 votes to stop this because it's a presidential election. So I need your help. We all do, so we can help the children. And people say, well, what's the plan to help? They're not. As we showed you, the Department of Education, Richard Wood's office, has a priority school plan that is working and improving, and so is the focus schools. From last year's, from year before last, those have definitely improved. It's a slow process.
If I can just say one thing really quickly, thank you. Again, my name is Brielle Bivens. I'm the regional field coordinator in North Georgia to defeat Amendment 1. If you all, so again, I'll just reiterate that this amounts to nothing more than a political power grab and a transfer of dollars and resources from local communities to a single political appointee, which to me is really terrifying. And I think none of us is sitting around sort of saying that we don't have schools that are underperforming, but I think the solutions have to come from the ground up, from the people that are in the communities day in and day out. Additionally, if you feel really passionately about this and are interested in getting involved, we definitely need help to spread the word, making phone calls, knocking on doors, talking to friends, things like that. So there is a little sign-up sheet in the back, and if you wouldn't mind signing up, that would be a great help. We're nearing the election, so and people are already voting, so we've got a lot of work to do. Thank you all.
So thank you so much for your time and attention, and go forth and spread the word. Thank you.
Thank you all very much. I'm always amazed and gratified by citizens such as we have right here who will leave their homes and travel out in the middle of the night and come out here and speak to a group of people about something they feel this strongly about. And it's a vital issue, and I think you shared some great information that we did not know about. Thank you very much for coming out and doing that for us. They really deserve a hand, as is so many. In fact, everybody here deserves a hand. Give yourselves a hand. You left your homes too. It's not like the speakers are the only people that leave home. You guys come in.